Good morning, everyone. My name is Marlene Edmunds. I'm the chief executive of Marlene Edmunds Media Consulting, and I've been in the media and entertainment industry for 25 years as a consultant and a journalist. We know it's never been a more exciting time for drama players across the globe, and we are lucky to have with us today some superstars of the drama industry to talk up cutting-edge issues that have arisen as a result of the globalization of drama. So first, let me introduce our superstars. Rand Tellem, raise your hand, is a former Keshet executive renowned for his work on Emmy Award-winning Prisoners of War, Homeland, and and now head of international content development for Mediapro, a company that has already played in the international big leagues of drama with productions like Woody Allen's Vicky, Christina Barcelona, and Midnight in Paris, and The Young Pope. Jimmy Desmarais, co-managing director, Atlantique Productions. Jimmy Desmarais is currently at work on Eden, the French-German contemporary political drama directed by Deutschland 83 Helmer Edward Berger. Before moving over to Atlantique last year at Haute Ecole, Jimmy worked on high-profile French skeins such as The Returned and Panthers. Once at Atlantique, he also helped bring Midnight Sun, among other titles, to the finish line. Kelly Wright, head of Latin America and executive advisor, Asian Pacific and the US. During Kelly's watch, Keshet International has struck up a deal with Telemundo Studios to co-develop and produce new original Spanish language drama and a multi-project, multi-year deal with Televisa to remake four scripted formats from Keshet International over the next 3 years. Moritz Polter, executive producer for international television series for Bavaria and now working on Das Boot, as well as Freud and... as former vice president of production for Tandem Productions, Polter worked, produced for the first three seasons of Crossing Lines, Spotless, and the miniseries Labyrinth. So let's get to it. We know that... I'm going to move over here for the moment. So we know that SVOD has helped push local drama into the global sphere, but it's not just about SVOD. Across the globe, players are increasingly willing to take more and more creative risks in order to find truly original storylines. So, and that's what happened when Rand Tellem and ULA's YLE's Yarmo Lampela got together to create the storyline for The Paradise, the first Spanish-Finnish drama co-production. Rand, tell us about how the idea of working together turned into some crazy brainstorming and somehow came together into a unique original Nordic noir set not in the frozen north, but rather in Spain.
So, good morning. The idea began with a meeting from David Troncoso from Mediapro and Yarmo from YLE. We've all been watching and following Nordic noir, and we were trying to explore a new way to tell a noir story. And we thought, is there a possible way to take noir stories and bring them over to a more sunnier, warmer place? And then as we started researching, we found that many Europeans, North Europeans, make their home in Spain.
Indeed.
And in the south of Spain, there is a small village called Fuengirola that has 15,000 Finns living in it in the summer.
For those who don't know, this is very close to Malaga.
Yeah, very close to Malaga. So what we did is we said, let's travel together. Let's go into this place together. So two Finns, one Spanish guy, one Israeli guy. We spent 3 days there together. At the beginning, we just introduced ourselves, talked about how we came to do television, what's our vision, what we love to do. Then we went meeting people in Fuengirola, trying to understand the story of what it is to have a Finnish community outside of Finland. How does it look like? What does it feel? What are the stories? And then for the third day of being there, we started creating.
So essentially for 2 days, you did nothing but sort of party and get to know each other.
It's not nothing, it's a lot.
But, and then you started writing.
Yeah, because I think it's really essential when creating co-productions. Mm-hmm. because we all speak about it in business terms, but I think it's much more a human thing than a business thing. And I think the best way to start creating co-productions is actually getting to know each other. And usually we're in a market and it's a limited time and it's 30 minutes and it's 2 hours and it's a lunch. And I don't think a co-production can work like that. I think it needs time and patience and getting to know the people. And for us now, it's a system. This is the way we construct co-productions. When we find a subject, we travel together, we spend the time together, and then we create it together.
Well, it's getting harder and harder to find really original ideas.
I don't think so.
So I think so. And so doing this kind of a creative sort of process, I think, helps that.
I think there's a lot of incredible ideas. They're completely out there. The only thing is to get the broadcasters to get convinced to put them on the air.
Okay.
But the amount of great ideas is infinite, I think. There's incredible stories to put out there. I don't think that there's ever going to be an end to it.
Okay. All right. I stand corrected. Okay. And I'm fascinated by the potential of the Iberian, Hispanic, Latin American triangle in film and TV. So Mediapro has some very big bridges to LATAM and Hispanic America. Can you, you have a few offices in Miami, I think? And
So Mediapro has offices in Argentina and Colombia and in Miami, and they're all very well connected to Latin America and America, which is a good ground to start projects, because they have very good connections with storytellers and with creators and with production companies. So it is easier for us to get to the stories and the best creators and start working with them using all the knowledge and the infrastructure that we have in Spain, but taking it to Latin America. And I must say, coming from Israel or coming from Europe, we all know a certain story of this world. But it's just one part of the story of the world.
Yes.
And I think there's a lot of, there's an abundance of incredible stories waiting in Latin America to be told. Mm-hmm. And we're there to try and do that.
Okay.
So we have a deal with Oficina Burman, with Daniel Burman, which is one of the most talented writers in Argentina, to start creating new dramas. We have two in the pipeline already, and it's just the beginning. We have two projects with Imagino US, with our Miami office. And I hope that in the near future, we can start telling you about what we're doing.
Okay, great. Thank you. And Kelly, Keshet is building bridges everywhere through co-production and a number of other alliances. Is making money and securing rights the primary motivation, or is it about creativity and collaboration, or all of those things and more?
It's about both and definitely more than that. You can't make money off of something which isn't great and unique as a story concept. And you can't transmit that story from paper to screen without supportive financing structures. So I think the tricky part here is to facilitate that, of course, and to make sure that both the financiers and the creatives have a payoff. Whether for the creators, it's having the freedom to tell their story, for the financiers to make a strong show which has strong revenue generation from the domestic and international markets. These things take a long time to negotiate, though. And the rights issue is very tricky, and it can become very political and challenging to overcome who will distribute, what part will be financed, who will take the first window. But if we can overcome that, and if you find partners whose motivations complement yours, then building a relationship, like Ron was saying, rather than building just a product, I think is really the way forward, and that's the route that we've taken as well. Mm-hmm. That allows us to have repeat collaborations, which means less posturing, less talking about deal making. You get that out of the way, and then you move into the production of the ideas themselves, and just get down to the business of making great TV. So two different deals that I want to talk about in that regard are with one with AMC and Sundance, where we've done The A Word with BBC One and Sundance as a collaboration and co-production. And the second coming up soon is Loaded with Channel 4 and AMC. So that's been a great relationship, which will continue to grow between ourselves and those clients. And then also with Televisa, as you mentioned. So we're doing four different scripted shows with Televisa, which you might think, what does Israeli TV have anything to do with Mexican content? They're so different from one another, but it's been a really fun collaboration growing and changing their marketplace and allowing some Israeli influence to take root there.
Eden is a co-pro between Arte France, Arte Germany, SWR, and Atlantique. It's a multilingual production, something Atlantique has quite specialized in. What lessons have you learned over the years about making these multilingual drama productions?
A Midnight Sun was in English, French, Swedish, Sami, and a little of Arabic. And before I was in Atlantique, I worked on Panthers, which was also in Serbian, French, English, a little Arabic. And now we are moving a step forward with Eden, which is going to be shoot in German, Greek, French, English, Arabic. The question for this choice is first, it's contemporary political dramas involving a lot of nationalities, a lot of countries, and we're looking for authenticity, knowing that in America people are used to seeing French, Korean, German speaking in English, in American in fact, whereas in Europe we're not used to this convention. And it's for us now a real way to emphasize the reality of these contemporary shows. It's also a way of getting really into other points of views, because these shows are confronting the stories of people from various countries, confronting their culture, their vision of history, and the subject somewhere is also this confrontation. And using the original languages helps bring a true immersion in these spheres. But then you also have the question of not losing the viewer and how to managing in this mix of all languages. So we are over with the experience of this kind of shows, we are trying also to be true to how it happens in the real world. I mean, today we all come from different backgrounds and we all speak English or Globish, depending on the level. And so in the way we work, we try to confront the characters as much as possible from different nationalities. And not develop too many scenes where we put only two Syrians together. Because, for example, in Eden, we have an Eritrean boy, we have a Syrian couple, we have a German couple, we have a French woman, we have a Greek guard. But the storylines just intertwine all the time. And then we will have, at the end, I think, a majority of English, which might be 70%. So it's a mix of taking into account the viewer and how to address a global audience, while being true to the reality, the authenticity of all of this.
And it's people are becoming used to some of these multilingual productions, I think. So as they are used to, if you live in Europe, you're used to hearing languages all the time that are not, I live in France, I live in Catalonia. You know, there are a number of different languages that are spoken around me, and even though I don't speak Catalonian, I do understand you begin to understand some of these things by expression, by context, and...
And it's been developing, especially because of the incredible increase of the circulation of series. I mean, it started with the Danish, with the Nordic, and it was funny how at some point some people thought they could even speak Danish or Swedish, and I think the viewer got used to it. At the same time, we have to counterbalance, because in France, for example, in the countries that dubbed, in France, in Spain, in Germany, most of the viewers watch it dubbed. On Canal Plus, when they broadcast the shows, the statistics is that 85-90% watch it dubbed. Mm-hmm. So there's sometimes a gap between having the multilingual version for the critics and for a small portion of viewers who really looking for this authenticity, but at the same time we know it will end up dubbed mostly.
Mm. Okay, all right. So Moritz, you will start lensing in August on Das Boot, the Bavarian Sonar Entertainment and Sky Germany production. It's Sonar's first non-English-speaking co-production, for the most part. And not, traditionally, players move to English as the major language to be assured of success, but this one is, for the most part, in German. Can the right title be an international hit no matter what the language, or...?
Well, I think on a subject like Das Boot, where it's already a brand that we are selling, it's much easier for an international partner like Sonar to come on board and say, okay, we are fine with doing it in German, predominantly German. Obviously, the Germans will speak German. There is a French resistance side who will speak French. And when Germans and French speak together, they might well speak English, because mm-hmm. it all depends on what the characters have learned in school, mm-hmm. Basically. So we are going with the authenticity that that Jimmy has been talking about, and obviously shows like Panthers paved the way in our opinion, or Carlos, to have multilingual shows and to have big budget multilingual shows. At the same time, it's still hard, and you need to get the American audience on board with it most, because in most other countries, as Jimmy said, the show might well be shown dubbed. I think that you know, doing international co-productions like we are doing on Arctic Circle that you mentioned earlier, which is a German-Finnish co-production, the main language will be English. And then there will be some German, there will be some Finnish in it. I think it's key that the shows come together naturally, and that the language is not an issue, and that language actually becomes less important, and you don't make a thing out of it. Mm-hmm. I think if you start to play too much the language card, meaning, you know, these two people can't understand those two people, in Europe nowadays, that doesn't work anymore, because we would all speak English. We're all sitting here coming from different nationalities, and we all can understand each other, mm-hmm. unless we don't want to be understood. Yeah. And I think that is key in developing these multilingual shows and co-productions in general. Otherwise, you get into the Euro pudding that we were in a couple of years ago. I also think that being able to do it multilingual gives you the opportunity to use actors from those countries, because we all have experience in using actors from France speaking English, pretending it's real English, and it doesn't really quite work, because you only have a very limited pool of people that speak that language good enough for them to act perfectly in the foreign language. And I think, you know, when they speak their own language, you will see it in their expressions, you will see mm-hmm. it in their performances. Mm-hmm. And if you then dub it, that's fine. But at least they have acted in a language that they are happy with, and yeah. I think you see
they
that
they have the body language that yeah. expresses the original
exactly.
language.
Exactly. You know, like when you hear Spanish, then you know it works with the arms, and yes. and if they then speak in English, they don't use the arms, and
yes,
suddenly that
true.
Spanish character doesn't seem Spanish anymore.
Yeah.
So I think that's you know it the authenticity is a big part of it. Das Boot is a special matter, because it's you know it's a brand, so it's easier.
I think it's about the story, not about the languages. I think the discussion about the language is a technical discussion. I think it needs to come with a story, and the story usually has a storyteller, and that storyteller usually has a language he writes in, and I think this dictates what the story is going to be. I never cared if the bridge was in any other language. It was just a brilliant show. Mm-hmm. And I think the same goes for Khatufim. We've seen here, people have watched it. And I think we have Walter Presents on Channel 4 right now, and people are watching Polish dramas and Israeli drama. And we have two Spanish shows from Mediapro on that channel. I think it doesn't make a difference anymore. Yes, people are accustomed to dubbing. They will still use it, but I think it's an evaluation. At the end of the day, the only thing that matters is the story.
Okay, and I know we're going to jump to some general questions, but do you want to weigh in on this as well, or Jimmy, do you want to weigh in on this?
My main question would be about how you qualify international success, because if there are a majority of countries in the world who are accustomed to watching things with subtitles or in dub, except for the US being a major exception, international success then becomes a different measurement.
You said before something which I truly agreed with, and you asked about making money, and you said we need to have a great story first. Mm-hmm. So that is my answer. Mm-hmm. You need to have a great story first, and then you can dub it, you can put subtitles to it, it doesn't really matter, you do what you're accustomed to, but the real story written by a person who usually writes in one language, most writers have a language they write with, you know, your fingers move on the keyboard in the language you know how to write. I think this is the key element. Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, you know, to counter that, you know, on Das Boot, we've got German writers and English writers. Actually, we've got three English writers and two German writers. The English writers obviously write in English. There will still be a lot of German dialogue.
Exactly, because that is the story.
But that's the story, exactly. And I think that you know, it doesn't really matter too much in what language you write. It matters what the characters would speak, I think. And it's about coming from the story, coming from the characters. Language, as you say, shouldn't matter. And I think if you make it matter too much, actually a lot of networks still do. And I think that's the first question they ask, so what language will they speak?
They still do.
I've had that now, multiple times. I don't think it actually matters. I think it's something that you just need to show them, and then they will buy into it. But it's one of the first questions that comes, across when we pitch something that is, a co-production.
I think it's kind of a hangover from traditional broadcasting, where you could not sell to territories unless you had a specific language and it was dubbed into if needed. Jimmy, you want?
Yeah, and I totally agree, confirm the subject. I mean, the question is not, I think it's a bad thing if you think how to make the show international. For me, the question is, why can't I make it national? And then I understand why this subject has to be multilingual or not.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Okay. So I'm going to open up to some general questions, and one of them is SVOD. So there are up and down sides of SVOD, and some people love it, some people don't. I think the smart people have, different relationships with it. So local producers see SVOD as a way of getting into international sphere, but there are big issues with rights, and SVOD can be helpful sometimes and sometimes not. So what are the issues involved? And Moritz, were you going to tackle that one?
I can at least start, that's for sure. I think SVOD helps because it broke up the traditional network system, so now we've got more people commissioning things, and because of that we can be more risky with our shows. Mm-hmm. In general, it also helps because talent obviously goes more global, and therefore there's a bigger pool to choose from, and meaning actors but also writers. We know more because we can get more. At the same time, I think that SVOD is not—it's not the golden age as it was presented at some point. It's just another step
in a tool. Yeah, exactly.
It's a tool of financing, and there are more players, and I think that's what's helpful.
Yeah, content-wise, at the beginning I thought, for example, local originals like Netflix, what they produce in each country, I thought, well, it's just another broadcaster. It's just another French broadcaster. But at the same time, it's interesting to see how it changes the way you think about your programs, because usually you have your national broadcaster, you know its audience, you know who they target. And anyway, if the project is first, you target this audience. And now the difference is that you have to make a local for the global. And you have to try to think, how do I do a local series that will appeal to the entire world? And it changes your perspective. So it's something that has come along also with the rise of international sales in the financing plan and the desire to try to think how the local programs, even if they are very local, and as we know, the global sells really well, it changes a little bit with Netflix, for example, because they really make you think how in the casting, in the subjects or whatever, how you make a French show that's an international show. And I think that's an interesting question to, even if I don't have any answers, as how do you do that?
Well, if it's universal enough, it should carry it both locally and internationally. You wanted to say?
I think, first of all, it's fun to watch. I love it. Mm-hmm. I love it that it's so easy and you get to get great content.
I can watch martial arts films on Netflix in French.
Everybody has his kick, but I think it has influence both on viewers and also on creators, because I think now we're much more exposed to the way content is done in many, many countries. Mm-hmm. And when you circle the globe and when you meet with writers across the universe, then you understand that we're all watching the same kind of things and we're creating in a different level. And I think what is becoming that we're writing deeper. We have much more layers to the shows that we're making, and I think it has a good influence. But I totally agree that the most significant part in these players is breaking up the market. Mm. A lot of market are closed, are in a standstill, and when the SVOD comes in and competition suddenly comes in, then everybody's open for new ideas. Mm-hmm. And this way you can create stuff which is a bit edgier, where the content is more complex, and I think it's great for both for content suppliers and for people who watch.
Great.
I think there are three points here, and one is about, you know, going back to local versus global. The local terrestrial broadcasters or linear channels, you know, are curating for a local market and a local audience, whereas these international SVOD platforms are picking and choosing based on, you know, algorithms and a more mathematical outcome, right? But they're still making brave choices, and I think that their acquisitions people are still making eclectic choices, and they're really representing a variety of different countries and giving people in Mexico access to Indian dramas and giving people in, you know, Korea access to maybe Finnish dramas that they wouldn't normally see. So I think that that's allowing for a spread of creativity. It's also attracting a lot of talent to those SVOD platforms by way of writers, actors, et cetera, because of that broad reach, that freedom of creativity, those more eclectic and brave choices. But going back to, as well, the issue of whether or not this global model works in terms of finances, I do think that there is a question here still that remains of whether or not monopolizing content in a way or consuming all rights, all revenues for programs.
That's a huge issue still. Yeah.
It's very controversial.
Yeah.
Yeah, and especially as you don't detain a lot of rights, finally, it's a threat to the independence of producers and how you manage to grow thanks to the catalog you create and how it helps you invest in development. If you're just for hired and you don't have this wild treasure year after year, it puts you in a more dependent position and with less freedom in the long run. That's a real issue, especially with the French system, which relies on the CNC and all.
Well, this is, for all the SVODs, or Netflix and Amazon, et cetera, this is a huge issue, and I don't see it being resolved anytime soon. I think we've been talking about it for about 5 years now. And Netflix doesn't give up its rights. I think they're becoming a tiny bit more flexible, but
yeah. I have a good example about that.
There's a little edge in there.
Yes, there is. They're doing a show called The Greenhouse Academy, which is based on an Israeli show called Achamama, and that's a teen daily drama. They produce an American version in Israel, and interestingly, they retain the rights exclusively worldwide for only 2 years instead of their typical very lengthy distribution rights situation. So those rights come back to, in this case, to Ananetic Short and Keshet after 2 years. So I think that there is some movement there.
Okay, great. Yeah. Thank you. So I wanted to move into something else. It's transcending political and other barriers. Now, we do have a very polarized world we're working in now, and some of the questions won't really be able to be asked, but they are out there. The EU is now requiring visas as of May for U.S. citizens coming into Europe who want to work or do anything else, really. The Brexit is, nobody knows what's going on with Brexit. There are issues in terms of independent production in China. There are a lot of regulatory issues with China. There are other issues, cultural issues, with working in the Middle East. And Kelly, do you want to start talking about that a bit?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I would like to highlight two of those markets, China and Brazil, which are very heavily regulated by government bodies, both in terms of content and in terms of fostering a preferential treatment for local independent producers. Mm-hmm. It is difficult to work in those markets because everything that you do there needs to be original to the local country, whether it's Brazil or China, in order to qualify for those quotas and to make it on the air in those local markets. So that's a challenge that should be discussed, because those are both enormous markets, which I think a lot of people probably in this audience would be interested in reaching as well. And then in regards to politics, you know, coming from the Middle East and having shows like Homeland, you know, and Ron can speak more about Homeland, tackle very controversial themes. And we saw what happened in Homeland when, you know, it airs in Lebanon, and there were a lot of things that happened in Lebanon and in Syria, which were very unpopular with the viewers there. So I think that these water cooler formats and shows are opening doors and exposing political issues that have kind of, people have been putting a Band-Aid on for many, many years now.
Yes.
But that's a powerful thing. And I think it's really fostered a huge conversation and a huge movement towards more political themed dramas.
Well, Jimmy, you were working on something which wasn't specifically political, but Eden is about refugees, and that's a huge issue all over the world, but specifically in Europe. And did you have any problems putting this together? Did you were there any issues?
Well, creatively, the interesting thing is to confront the point of views on the same subject between the French, the German, in the writers' room, between the writers, because you realize that there are very different stands. I mean, where what France does, how Germany deals with the project, and on an everyday basis, we raised misunderstandings and cultural differences. It happens on many projects, and I think that's the beauty of collaborating between countries. We had a project we worked with an Israeli writer, and we took weeks to explain what is secularity in France, and the place of religion. And at the beginning in the script, we had a police officer who did an operation with her religious sign here, and we were like, no way, it's not possible. And it took time to adapt. So in the confrontation of the point of views, I think then reflects in the work, in the series, and becomes mm-hmm. the real subject of it.
Yeah.
I think drama has to be relevant. Mm. And by being relevant, it touches usually mm-hmm. the most controversial issues.
Yes.
So if you're thinking coming to working in drama, it's going to be a smooth ride with no politics involved, you're wrong. It's going to touch every subject and then go deep and deep into the wound.
Well, we've gone through a period where we're kind of stuck on it has to be entertaining, it has to be entertaining, but what does that mean? I think that we really do need to start digging into some of these things.
Yeah, I think drama for the past years, for the golden era of drama, has been really strong in touching the most controversial issues and sometimes bringing up subjects from autism to nationalism to anything and putting them on the table and dealing with them. Mm-hmm. And I think we see more and more that the more you take a subject which is controversial, the more you go deep into it, mm-hmm. even though the more you make it local story, the better it is to travel around the world. It's actually completely the opposite of creating something which is entertaining and light.
Yeah. Well, I liked what was done with Midnight Sun as an example, because the issues, the local issues of native Lapland in the
Samis.
Yeah, Samis. Excuse me. Yeah, I mean, I think that's a huge thing. It's not just the Samis; it's all over the Inuit nations, you know. And to touch on that, even to just touch on it, I think was important.
Yeah, absolutely. And to come back to your question about the political barriers and how the world is evolving and the more barriers we get, I think we'll overcome any measures. We'll find ways. It's going to be very problematic in terms of production. There are going to be a lot of obstacles. But for example, funny enough, just after the Brexit and when we were discussing with all our British partners, would it be broadcasters, producers, writers, they're even more eager to collaborate. And sometimes mm-hmm. the British, you know, are really in their islands and they are like, they have a special position in Europe. And now, even if we don't know how the Brexit, the consequences, what it will be very concretely, I'm starting working with British writers on European projects, and they just want to make bridges just
yep.
in advance.
I've noticed that as well when I've been interviewing a lot of people who are, you know, Pinewood is an example. Everybody's looking for ways to go around, build bridges right now, because nobody knows what they're doing.
I think that you know, day after Brexit happened, one of the writers that we have, or our head writer Tony Saint from Das Boot, he immediately called and he said, "So what's going to happen? Am I still on the show?"
Yeah.
Obviously he is, but looking into the future and looking into the, you know, imminent future of the next 2-3 years, it's a big question mark whether British writers will still count for the French system, for instance, you know, whether they are still eligible in that sense. So I think there is an issue right now, mm-hmm. because when you start developing now, you know that you're going to be in production in, you know, a year or 2 years' time. So starting new projects now with UK writers could be an issue, could be something mm-hmm. that is a little bit, you know, more problematic. I absolutely agree that we'll overcome it, but it's you know, it's a question of, do you risk it, you know, at the moment. But on the other subject, that obviously, you know, in today's world where politics is so much more on the agenda of everyone, I think, you know, a lot of people are now reading newspapers again, for the first time in their lives, which is fantastic, and people are watching more news. I think it paves the way for productions that are coming out of this wake that will be a lot more political and that will have a lot more to say, but obviously packaged in a way that it's accessible. Mm-hmm.
We're working on a show now in Argentina telling an incredible story about the bombings of the Israeli embassy and the Jewish and the Jewish foundation in Argentina about 25 years ago. Mm. It's a highly political story. It involves Iran and Lebanon and the US and Israel and Argentina. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, it's the story of one man, a spy with double agents and double personalities. And I think it's a fascinating story. And it's a very controversial subject. You touch it and it's very hot anywhere you touch it. But at the end, it's just an incredibly fascinating story about identity, mm-hmm. which I think is something that we all right now are asking ourselves every morning we get up. and about those visas, I'd like to say as an Israeli, I wait in every possible line in every airport.
Okay.
I never get to cross that incredible line.
Okay.
So I invite you to join me on that line. It takes an hour usually. You have time to think about your next show, and then you get in.
Okay. Kelly, did you want in on this, or I was going to move to the next subject?
I just thought what Ron said about really responding to what's relevant topics of conversation and elevating that conversation with a stylized fictional show is really what we do. And mm-hmm. I don't think any of us are trying to intentionally stir up hornet's nest or put moralize or put judgments out there, but just to bring that conversation onto the screen, yeah. make it glossy, and talk about it.
Yeah, thank you. So one of the things that I'm interested in is just basically ratcheting up creative alliances. And I think we've talked a little bit about that. And, What? Oh, excuse me, I'm using it. No. So, as an example, Atlantique is behind a move to network with producers with the aim of bringing top talents together. Jimmy, can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it came after a few years ago at the MIP when it started really increasing the meetings, the mixing all the people together. I was a bit surprised that you had 20 minutes. And people arrived with a well-built project, sometimes with well-advanced script. And it was like, you have 20 minutes to decide if you're going to get married. And I was a bit like, I don't know you. I don't know how you work. I don't know how the process and et cetera. And I really think this is the danger of turning into your pudding, as you were saying. So we are trying, we try to develop a small network of producers we kind of like at the beginning, and like five European countries, and we meet up regularly, and sometimes we have workshop with writers, and there are a few goals, like really knowing each other and how we work, so that when one day a good project pops up, we know how to work together, and we have created development deals with European companies that are it comes out of encounters, personal encounters, and upcoming producers, for example, we really like. It's not capitalistic. The goal is just to help them grow their company and give development budgets, but then we brainstorm on their projects, and we have a deal with a German producer. Like, we even brainstorm on his purely German projects, but it helps him get out of the pure, national audience of his own broadcaster to try to think the project wider, and I think the next step now would be to think how to create more spaces for meetings between writers, because in all these festivals, all these markets, all these meetings, we have a lot of the distributors, broadcasters, producers are here all the time. We meet every month, all around the world. We could be in a plane without landing. But the writers and the directors are not. They are here only if they have a project. Mm-hmm. So there is a real stake of creating a community of people, and I'm convinced out of this will emerge strong subjects that are really coming from the guts,
I completely agree with you. This is exactly what we're doing, and I find it more than also interesting. It's just amazingly fun to do together, sit with incredible minds and incredible people and create together. That is the way we should do it.
We tried to do we did a workshop on comedy with the writers and producers, and it was the hardest, but we wanted to try for fun. And it was really difficult to see how we didn't manage to make everybody laugh at the same joke. During 4 hours, we tried to find subject and ideas. And
you need to increase your alcohol budget.
No, we always start with a dinner in the evening and we drink a lot. And the hardest was with the German, actually. The difference was higher.
Well, we have something.
Going to have to go to the questions right now. So
Okay, well, we've got one German-French comedy that we're developing. You will laugh, I'm sure.
I'm very curious of that.
In the right places.
Okay, sorry to interrupt you guys, but we're going to call for questions. If there's no questions, then we'll go on for another minute or so. We need a microphone over there.
Yeah. Anil Vanvari from Indian Television. Just checking, when you're writing, it's across two or three countries. How do you get the sensibilities right? You know, there are nuances which you have to take care of. Local in one country and in another country, it doesn't work. How do you get that really perfect? And do you have to have different versions, different edits for countries, for different nations which are buying into the product?
Did any of the
I think the heart of the question is to have one voice. And one talent director or main writer who will be the leader of it, and then it's not a question of compromising. It's just a question of getting to another level where it speaks to everybody while respecting each writer's sensibility inside the room. But you still, the key is to have the one voice. I think
you can use it as an advantage, not as a disadvantage. So if you have a character that comes from another nationality and has different ways of acting, I think it's fascinating and interesting. You put it on the table, and then you can write this character correctly. But the main way to do it is, of course, you have a head writer. You have a one voice that dictates what the plot is going to be, which characters are important. This is how you, because it is impossible to conduct a democracy when you write a show. Mm-hmm. It never works.
Okay, we have time for one more question over there. Excuse me, sorry. Thank you. Oh, I thought I saw a hand up over there. Yeah.
Hi, thank you very much. Very interesting panel. But I actually want to know what stories do travel, because you keep to say great stories, controversial stories. Give me a couple of more examples. Is it family values? Is it love? What makes universal story? Sometimes, maybe example, something worked and something didn't work that you thought globally.
You identify yourself?
Yes, my name is Anna Morozova. I'm a business development executive for Russia Television and Radio.
Thank you.
I actually don't think there is an answer to that question, because that's exactly it. I think great stories don't matter whether it's crime or whether it's drama or whether it's, you know, a personal family story. It's all about the character themes, and if it's about family works the same way all over the world. And I think, you know, at the heart of pretty much every successful show, there is that family element, whether that's in a crime or in a drama or in a comedy, it's what we can relate to.
And I think you shouldn't be concerned about when you're in the process of doing it, you shouldn't think about making it global or address a global audience. When we did The Return, we wanted to be really French, and we didn't think it would travel. The goal was to tackle with the genre from a very, very French point of view, and that was our only concern. And then finally it ended up traveling a lot. So
I think most of the surprising successes have been exactly that. Mm-hmm. And I mean, Prisoners of War being something which is so local, so Israeli, about, you know, abducted soldiers, and that happened to be relevant to a lot of other countries and fascinating for people to dig into. But I think there are two real answers to that question, and one is about broad topics, you know, American comedies and more procedural crime dramas, which, you know, hit everybody and are popular all over the globe. And then those specific local stories, which expose or highlight something which you might have thought about but never really understood, and that just dig their hooks into you and don't let you go.
I think there's no answer. I think it's a great question, and there's no answer to it. You never know. Even when you think you have the greatest story in the world and you convince people to do it and you put it on air and it fails. And so you can never know. Only trust your instincts. That's the only thing.
It's like asking.
Trust your instincts, and bottom line, there are universalities for everyone, every human being. So
it would be like asking, how do you make a big success?
But it's an example, Border Town, which is wholly local Finnish-French co-production. Border Town has been a phenomenal success, and I think part of it is because it balanced family with larger issues, and it was a crime drama that helps. Okay, well, thank you all very much for your being here this morning, and I hope you have a great day. And thank you, panelists, for all of your work.
Thank you.